Anthony Dolman Jones, and I teach in and direct the At-Risk and Alternative Education Masters of Arts in Education degree program, a graduate program, obviously, at Marion University, home campus, Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. But our program is online 100% and all over the country in availability. Caring. This is a topic that we've been discussing recently in one of the classes. It is a key concept. I've heard the expression, kids do not care how much you know until they know how much you care. If I hear that one more time, I might get sick. It's still true, probably, but that's just me. I've heard it so many times, and it's misleading because sometimes it's not true. I've had professors who didn't care about me at all, and I learned a lot from them. But again, I was older, so some of your mature students are really there for an education or in there to advance themselves and could care less whether the teacher cares. But in general, most of your students resonate, shall we say, with a caring teacher. Some teachers care a lot about themselves. Their ego needs polishing a lot. And I could tell you stories of my teachers, but it's better if you just remember some of yours who had egos that they needed, like an Oscar statue, they needed to polish with their words, their actions, their other behaviors. A lot of those teachers say, this is my room. The students don't have any ownership in the room. This is my room. And you'll do what I say because you're in my room. It's going to be hard to feel like you're cared for in a situation like that as a student. There are some teachers who care very much about their own needs. I have known, I'm gonna uplift this in a minute, but I have known teachers, and so have you, who may not have had power anywhere in their lives until they became a teacher, and they abuse it. They're pretty apparent, but that doesn't mean you don't suffer if you're one of their students for 9 months, or Lord forgive if you get them for 2 years. They're disgusting. But when you're a student and you're in that room and they control your life, so to speak, you have a tendency to help them meet their needs. And this is one of the most near evil things. Not done intentionally, necessarily, sometimes, but that exists because students are not there to fill students are not there to fill teachers' needs any more than kids come into the world to satisfy their parents' needs. But how often is that not true? So we make do. People are resilient for the most part. Yes, sometimes one teacher can set a kid off in a pretty dangerous or sad, or because they were told they were stupid or will never amount to anything. Oh, those are real. I sit in a very interesting position because I teach teachers who are working in the field at the time. They tell me stories about themselves, very humbly, that they things they've overcome, and about colleagues that they have that they're ashamed of, and about their own teaching or student experiences, the teachers they've had. And so I get a lot of information about this, a lot of information about it. And excuse me, I'm just getting over a bout with bronchitis, so my throat still needs a lot of lubricating. Hang on a minute. As a matter of fact, I wanted to make this video some time ago. We also know that there are teachers who are wrapped up in self-pity. Self-pity is a dangerous attribute. Self-pity is at the bottom of almost every addict. If you scratch an addict deep enough, you will find self-pity at the core. I don't care how they come across on the surface, angry or despondent or whatever. They're very full of self-pity. And I've maintained sometimes that the reason why people are encouraged to keep drinking or drugging or whatever is because there's no way out of self-pity by doing it enough. You just cannot sit down and go, poor me, poor me, poor me, without saying, poor me another one. It hurts too much. And you need some medication. So the only way out of self-pity is to stop. I know, that's simplistic, but it's the truth. It's just stop. Stop doing it. And then it will dissipate. It will evaporate. If you don't feed it, it goes away. But you can never do it enough. It really is annoying to listen to. And I know because I've listened to myself do it. Okay, so have you probably. So what is caring? Well, I'm going to give you a definition in context because that's what I am concerned about. In context, a caring educator is, it's like one of the backbone beliefs of our program is that we believe that education is about helping kids succeed in school and in life. So when you, caring about a student is about being concerned about them in the now, but also what happens in the now, how it will impact them in the future. So you kind of have to be goggle-eyed. You have to have one eye on what's going on now and another eye like, if I do this, how will that positively affect or impact the student down the road? That takes concern. That takes caring, because why would you spend energy on someone with all of that if you didn't care? So to me, even though it doesn't sound like very mushy and give me hugs and kisses and everything, caring, it's really about a deeper kind of caring, an adult kind of caring that says, you know, what should we do to make sure that you succeed now? And then not just that, but how that will impact you in the future before we take any action. So that's my definition of caring, and that's the one I try to pass on to my students here in the ARAE program, because school is about success, but it's not about succeeding in school. It's about succeeding in the rest of your life. School is supposed to prepare you for life. So a lot of people think, well, if you succeed in school, you'll succeed in life. That's not true. Always. There are people who succeed in school and commit suicide right after they get out, or go into a life of crime, or, you know, do something really beneath their potential for the rest of their life. So you can succeed in school and not necessarily succeed in life. Once again, a caring teacher looks at both. How can we help you succeed here and now in school and in the future? In your life. And understand the power of that, because you're impacting not only the student now, but in the future in their children, children's children. That's how important it is to be a great teacher, because you're affecting generations. Another example of caring, I was privileged to work on get this title, Elementary Teacher Preparation Model Project. Elementary Teacher Preparation Model Project at Florida State University. Just a little bit of history. there were 8 universities applied and were granted, I don't know, a few hundred grand to put together a model of the perfect teacher preparation program. You know, that was the deal. Who, and we were in competition with each other because the winner was going to get $1 million to install the program in their university. So there was a lot of motivation. And I wasn't the only one on this staff. I was one of, well, varied from 5 to 15 because we had consultants coming in and so forth, and volunteers and temporary people that we need, support people we needed. It was a very intense program because not only were we just like researching and pulling things together from the literature and each other's experiences, we actually applied it. That was part of the grant, is that you had to put some of this into action to see if it worked, not just write up some good sounding stuff and send it. That's how we got to be one of the 8, was just writing up good sounding stuff, which we know how to do that as graduate people. My professors did anyway. We borrowed the Mormon church, and we had a corral, a big room in the back of the church, and where we kept kids, literally kept kids in a corral. Well, they were being entertained with movies and so forth to keep them there. And then we used Sunday school rooms, which were very small, and we had a row of them along the wall. And the situation was that the person who was going to be a teacher was stuck in this room with, I think, 3 to 5 kids, and had a certain skill that they had prepared for and they had to implement, and they were being taped. And outside the room, at the end of the cables, there was a professor with a pad evaluating the student's performance live. And then when the student finished, they were only allowed to teach for like 10 to 15 minutes or less. When they finished, they went in another room with the video and sat down with the professor and went over the what we call mini module, or micro teaching experience. It was an amazing experience. But out of that, we were looking at a very linear way, which is easy to understand, linear way of like, what is the first thing a teacher should know? First thing. What's the first thing a teacher should be good at? And again, out of the literature and experience, we had some very experienced teachers there, people who had been in the public schools, superintendents, so forth, now professors. Been around the block, you know. They knew stuff. Anyway, to cut to the chase, we wound up with the one word, rapport. That the first skill that a teacher needed was to establish a rapport with students. Well, think about that. What does that word mean? It means a relationship, and it means there's caring in there. So how do you show a child you care? And we broke that down into a set of sub-skills. It was an amazing experience because you don't think, you know, well, you should care for students. Oh, yeah, man, I agree. Care for students. It's a good idea. Yeah, it really works. What is that? What's that made up of? If you were going to teach somebody who didn't know how to care, what would you teach them? Because we can all learn if we're in education. I always said the best learner in the room should be the teacher. That's a real professional educator. So, well, we went through the usual. Make eye contact with the students. And one of the first things you have to do is learn their names. Why? Because we're known by our names. It's part of our identity. I mean, I don't care if your name is Rufus or Tinkerbell or Leadbetter or Jane or whatever. That's your name. And we come to identify with that as being part of us. So when a student goes, what's your name? I don't know. But anyway, I mean, that's dismissive and it's wounding. Just because a teacher knows your name doesn't mean they care, but it's a component. It says, I know you as an individual because I know your name. Second of all, we make eye contact with a student. Now, different societies don't believe in eye contact. And that's okay, but we're talking about our culture. We usually give a high value to it, making eye contact. It's a way to say, I see you there, okay? So sometimes another skill, sub-skill of this rapport building was meeting and greeting the students when they came in, shaking their hands, walking them by their names. Some teachers believed you should stand at the door when students leave and make eye contact and, you know, show you care. That you're basically going to miss them until you see them again. Maybe this is asking too much of some people, but these were the little pieces we teased apart that we taught students how to do. How to smile genuinely. And then we get into those things about, you know, the mixture of, you know, being firm, but yet being friendly. You know, being fair, but also acknowledging that, as the old saying goes, fair is where the Ferris wheel is, that some kids need more than others. Even though it may look unfair, it's really, it's about compensatory teaching. Is that some kids need extra time with something to get up even with other kids. Is that unfair that they get 10 minutes of tutoring as opposed to 2 minutes of tutoring? Well, the one kid only needs 2 minutes of tutoring. The other kid needs 10. As a matter of fact, it's quite fair, but it may look unfair. Okay. So how to keep all that, the firm, fair, friendly thing going? And of course, the big piece I've always felt after firm, fair, and friendly is consistency or persistence. In other words, continue to show the student that you care, not just one day. Not just a friendly pat on the back and there, I care about you, now you got it. You know, that's it. That we need to be consistent. We need to be consistent with the firmness and the fairness. We need to be consistent in our identifying the student as an individual, that we're concerned about their success. Now, yes, I've heard from, as we talk about caring in one of my classes, I've heard the horror stories, and I've got my own from non-caring teachers, and I don't know what to say about that, except why do they stay? It's got to be just torturous to be in a school full of kids that you don't like, doing a job you don't like, for whatever reason. Maybe you don't know what to do. Maybe, and that happened. I think there are a lot of people who just don't know what they're doing. They're faking it and it's not working, and so they hate their job and they blame the kids. And they'll say that in the teacher's lounge, you know, that's a self-pity piece. You know, these kids are driving me crazy. You know, just need to get rid of some of them. You know, in other words, it's their fault. Nothing the teacher's doing. You know, the teacher feels like they're bringing 100% of everything to the classroom and the kids just don't appreciate it. I mean, that's so far from the truth that it's ridiculous, but you can convince yourself that's true. Especially if you hear it from other teachers going, yeah. I just advise my teachers, as I call them, to stay away from people like that, negative influences, because it's contagious. I mean, let's be honest, people care more about negative things than positive things. The evening news is full of negative stuff. You think there aren't positive things going on in equal, if not, you know, maybe even monumental proportions compared to bad things? But my stepfather was a journalist and a very intelligent man, and very straightforward, and he said, never forget this. He was talking about the media in general, newspapers, television, radio. It's about selling advertising. Whatever gets people's attention, call them sticky eyes, gets their eyes to stick on the channel, stick on the page, stick their ear to the radio longer in order to hear the commercials. And so you're not going to hear radio without some kind of commercials or something asking for money very often, because that's how they support themselves. And, you know, as one guy said, you know, thank goodness there's advertising, it wouldn't be television. I mean, well, that's a stretch, but anyway, you know, we endure it. But it does work also on subliminal basis that you do wind up saying, I want Coca-Cola, not Pepsi. The Eds are cuter. Who knows what? Or your dad says Coke's better and Pepsi has mice in it or something. I don't know. That was awful. Sorry. So uncaring teachers, just stay away from them. They can come around, some of them. Some of them are burnt out, and it's sad. And I say to you, if you're an administrator listening to this, you must do whatever you can to move these people out of the classroom. If you worked with them and they can't overcome it, you've got to get them out of the classroom. They're doing more damage than good. I mean, you can put them in a position of non-contact with kids. A lot of work has to be done. It's not really contacting kids. Or maybe they'd be, you know, come out of their shell and be a happier person if they were doing the right job. Maybe they would be better off in some other aspect of the school. You know, they'd feel more fulfilled. All right, enough on that. How can you care about somebody that you can't care about? I mean, that's the real challenge. I've had two students named Vinny who were both just the test. I've also found, is this a coincidence that kids named Chuck are a handful? Chuck and Vinny seem to be a handful. This is probably my filtering of my life, what I've noticed. But these are like the real challenge. You know, these are like Androcles and the lion. You know, you're going in there, you alone against the lion. Vinny's the lion. And now somebody in the background's going, okay, show me your care. It can be done. And I've shared this with one or two of my students. Well, let's realize that not caring is enhanced, magnified by distance. This is one of those laws of human physics that teachers need to understand about the laws of physics. How you seat children in a classroom is going to change the energy of the classroom. What they do in the classroom, who they can talk to, what they can get away with, okay, so forth. How you know, sometimes how high your lab tables are if you're teaching a science course changes things. That's why we have small chairs in kindergarten, you know, instead of great big chair, because it makes a difference. We've understood that there are laws of human physics. So, and this is one of them, that distance from somebody you probably don't like makes it worse, makes you like them even less. And it makes you gather information from a distance because we'd rather be right than happy sometimes. See what Vinny, I heard what Vinny did today, another reason why there's no reason to get close to him. Okay. So what is the cure? This is really, really, really simple. Get close. I know, part of you is going like, this is why home visits work. I'm the two most successful teachers I ever knew up close and personal made home visits. One guy made two a year to each home, one in the beginning of the year and one at the end. He had no discipline problems. Parents loved him. Now, some parents wouldn't let him in the house. Some houses he was really sorry he was in because they looked contagious. But he said it was, again, the physics. He said the next day after you make a home visit to a kid's house, you and that kid have a different relationship. It's hard to explain. It's just different. Just because you moved your molecules into his house or her house changes the relationship. Why? Because it says you can. I mean, to give up your evenings to knock on a door and say hi, drink somebody's bad coffee or tea, sit on the couch you wonder if you should be touching, maybe. It's not always true. Sometimes you're in a very ritzy house and you feel like you shouldn't sit on the couch because you're dirtier than the couch, maybe. But anyway, to put forth that energy shows that you care. Amen. I did it for a few of my students that I knew needed it, and it was a major chore, you know. I mean, once I did it, it was one of those things like doing a workout. You don't look back and go, I'm sorry, I worked out. I mean, once I made the visit, I was like, well, that was a good thing to do. But thinking about, okay, I'm tired, and now I've got to grab a quick lunch, and I got to go out, and I can see two parents tonight, 6:15 and 6:45, and so forth, is wearing and tearing. But you do it because you care, and the students get that. So that's another way to show that you care. Well, let's take Vinny. What you can do with Vinny. So instead of keeping your distance and going, you just prefer Denny just to get sick. Of course, they never, Vinny's never get sick. They're always in school. Is to pull them closer to you, not with your hands, but get closer to them and make eye contact. And basically send this message from pupil to pupil, no pun intended, absolutely, from pupil to pupil. Say it to yourself silently, I see you in there. I see you in there. I see you. You, I see. I'm not looking at an eyeball. I'm not looking at a student. I'm looking at you. Something beyond the body. Wow, you want to talk about powerful contact. Don't do that for too long. But just to let them know that you see something other than the trappings of, society, their behaviors, their clothing, their mannerisms, and so forth, is that you see the real person, and you still want to stay close. Another powerful message. Well, it's kind of like making the home visit. Very similar in terms of the energy of it. Okay, so try that. And then after that, follow up with making sure that you make eye contact during the day, and once in a while say, what'd you do this weekend? Or, hey, man, that's a cool. I used to say to students, man, those are cool socks. I'd look good in those. That always made them laugh. I don't know why. Probably the same reason I'm laughing right now. Okay. That's one way you can overcome. You can start to care for a student you don't care for. Just get closer. I say people try it. Experiment. See if it works for you. I want to say one last thing. There's a man that I admire. Actually, I'm going to say two last things. It's a man I admire a lot. His name is Jerry Conrath. Jerry was an at-risk teacher and has done some consulting. I know he's through consulting now. He's got some health problems. I picked him up at the airport for a couple of workshops we did here at the university, and I drove him up from Milwaukee and I took him back, and it was a great opportunity to pick his brain. One of the things that's a lot of things he said stuck with me. Read his books are not fancy. They're like spiral bound, self-published books. Got some really great down-to-earth wisdom in Conrath, Conrath, Jerry Conrath. But this is the one that stuck with me. He says, the first 10 minutes of a class are the most important. When you meet students for the first time, that first 10 minutes are the most important 10 minutes of the year. Because you're going to send three messages across to the students, and you're going to mean them. The first message you're going to send the students is that this is an accelerated class. And he said, the students look around going, am I in the right room? Because if you're in an at-risk classroom or alternative, a classroom is like a, well, it must be a dumbed down classroom. He said, absolutely, just the opposite. We got a lot of stuff to do. We're going to move, hit the ground running. It's an accelerated class because I think that much of you. I know you can handle it. And I do that. And he says, and the second thing is I expect all of you to pass. I expect all of you to pass, all of you to graduate. Now, some of you may not. I mean, I'm a realist. But my expectation, I'm going to approach this class and you fully, 100% expecting you to succeed. And furthermore, I'm going to do everything I can to help that happen. If we need to meet after school, I'll do it. If you need to come in on Saturday, I'll come in on Saturday and we'll do it. Sunday afternoon, Friday night, whatever it takes to help you succeed, you let me know. And I'll be there for you if I can. Can't be there at that time, we'll make an appointment for another time. Now, that's caring. Commitment again, okay? The last thing he said was, "You are with the right teacher." Now, what does that say? It says, you know, I want to be here. It said, I belong here. You and I belong together. You belong here with me. I belong here with you. You've got the right teacher. Okay. It sounds like a simple thing to say, but that's a big message. Because you're also saying, I like being here. I like being here. He told me also, he didn't edit, he said, just be human with students. Be a human being. You know, some days you don't feel good, tell them. Or it's okay to show it. You may be angry. It's okay to show your anger. You don't have to act it out. Nobody gets hurt by talking about their anger or even letting it show on their countenance. How you get hurt is by suppressing it and exploding one day. And again, you don't have to act out your anger, but it's okay to let students know you're a little perturbed or a little PO'd about something. It may not even be what's in the classroom. Just say, I'm working through something. So appreciate your tolerance for me today. I don't feel good today, or I don't know why I'm feeling a little down today. Because see, they all have those. They all feel angry and suppress it. They all feel a little down and don't understand. They have moods. So that's another way of establishing rapport, letting them know you're a human being, while still being firm, fair, friendly, and persistent. All right, last thing I want to say is that if you're not familiar with that program, I have given the name to our students as Angel Warrior Educators, especially the ones who graduate. And in one of the classes, we talk about what those characteristics are, because some teachers are angels. My Mrs. Anderson, the fifth grade, was absolutely an angel. People laugh, but you know, you got to get back into that kid mind. I had heard a rumor that she was an angel. And that sometimes she forgot and let herself float a little bit off the floor before she remembered and got back down, you know. I can tell you all the shoes she wore, because I spent a lot of time watching her feet trying to catch her, and I swear one day I think I caught her. I think one foot was off the floor and the other one was like a quarter inch maybe, and just for a second. You know, she never raised her voice. She always had a smile. She knew all of our names. She would go the extra mile if we needed help. I've never heard her say an angry word. I never saw her get derogatory to anybody. As I said, she never raised her voice, never needed to. We hung on every word. We worshipped her. She was the epitome of the angel at one end. At the other end is the warrior educator, and I've had those former Marines, you know, guys who were former cops or guys who were have been through some hard times in their life. They were passionate, though, about teaching, and they wanted to really impart to you what they knew to help you get through life. They saw life as a tough place, and you better be a little bit hardened to get through it without giving up your humanity. They showed they care, but they may not have been very touchy-feely. I've also known angel warriors who are passionate about their subject matter, and that catches students on fire. So most teachers are a mixture who are successful in at-risk education, or a mixture between angel and warrior, some characteristics of each. But I guarantee you that every successful at-risk educator is an angel warrior educator. Okay. I like to think that we are prepared graduates from my graduate program, unlike any other program in the world, could be airdropped in the morning into a group of at-risk kids, and by the evening have things happen, moving things along, making progress in one day. That's how prepared they are. That's how much they care. That's how hard they're willing to work. I try to keep them in touch with each other, because it's easy to burn out if you're all by yourself. I don't care how passionate you are, how much you care. It's easy to burn out if you're by yourself, nobody understands you. I mean, at-risk teachers often are looked down upon by their own colleagues. It's just really silly, but it happens. Like you're radioactive or something because you work with that kid. I mean, I had a student who worked with, quote, regular ed teachers for 8, 12 years, bowling leagues, ate lunch with them and everything. And as soon as she started teaching in the at-risk program, the other teachers shunned her. And, you know, one of your kids was out there by the dumpster, you better do something. And then walk away, you know, like, don't touch me. I mean, she was in tears. Like, what happened? We were friends. You better be ready for that. So that's why I encourage our Angel Warrior educators to stay in touch with each other. That's why NARIN, the National At-Risk Education Network, was formed, was to provide a gathering place, if not physically, at least spiritually, for Angel Warrior educators to keep their batteries, you know, full, to learn new things, because things change, you know, the media, social media and internet and the digital world has changed things, accelerated change immensely, and our people need to stay up to date, so they need to learn from each other as well as from, you know, self-improvement courses or faculty development workshops or consultants or whatever. So that's, bring that back around, that's a journey about caring. And I wanted to do this because it's rather a amorphous topic. You know, you can't say I'm against caring, but if you ask somebody to define it, you know, real quick, they'll fumble all over themselves. If it's that important, we should really know what it is. So hopefully you know better what it is if you didn't already. All right? Okay. We're not singing Kumbaya, but we understand what's behind that. Being humans. Being human. We're different than giraffes, and dinosaurs, and sharks, and even kittens. We're different. We're humans. And we need to be, show our humanity. And one of the top ways to do that is through caring. Okay, enough said. See you soon.